Good morning. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I am Pastor Mary Ann Kallenbach, pastor at Living Faith Church, which is located in the city of Port St. Lucie in the state of Florida. And I welcome you to worship on this, what we call Palm slash Passion Sunday. We have so much happening here. At Living Faith. I forgot where I was there for a second. Sorry about that. First, I want to make sure that everybody who is present has a palm. Palms. If there are any left over, don't worry, they're not going to go to waste. You can take some. I will be bringing some home and placing them on my front yard and inviting anyone in the neighborhood or anyone who would like to come and take a palm. Actually, 4 years ago, I had placed palms. Remember, 4 years ago, we were not gathered together for Palm Sunday. And so I had taken the palms that had been ordered previously, prior to the shutdown, and I placed them out at the foot of our front walk there and invited folks to come and take palms. And there was a woman who came. She happened to be a doctor at the emergency room I think it's I can't even think of the name of it. But anyway, she came, she got out of the car and she waved and she said, "Oh my gosh, thank you so very much for these palms. I wanted to get them for my mother and I was afraid that I wouldn't find any." And then I said, "Absolutely, take as many as you need." And she told me she was a doctor at the in the ER. And I had then said, "Thank you for your service." I left, I went into the house, and I wanted to come back out just to say hello to anybody who came and got the palms, and she came back with a dozen roses and said, "You have no idea how much this meant to me that I was able to bring palms to my mother." And she laid them on the sidewalk, and then she got in her car and waited until I went and picked them up. Remember the whole, we were distancing from each other? And just, I mean, oh my gosh, what a wonderful reciprocal gift we were able to give each other in these joyous palms. So please make sure you take some palms. And also, there are special palms. Do you see the special palms? For those of you who are worshiping from afar, oh, you are going to wish you were here. So these are beautiful, handmade cross palms. And these palms come from the church property. So they were made by Pat Weigel. Thank you so very much. I had asked her to make 100, and she probably made 100 plus. So please make sure that you take one of these. And actually, Maddie, I have a special one for you because we don't have a children's sermon today. So, Maddie, I see you back there. I have a special palm for you. Come get your palm. Which one would you like? Which one do you think? You want to take this one? Isn't that beautiful? And Miss Pat made them. Miss Pat is sitting right back there. She made these by hand, and these are the palms that are on the church property. Isn't that awesome? Yeah, yeah. So you're going to learn all about the palms today as you hear in worship, okay? Okay, you could head back now. A couple of announcements that I do have. Last day to order your Easter lilies, so you want to make sure that you do that. The forms are in the back. They look like this, just so you know. Next. Songs I Love to Sing 2, T-O-O. We have another concert lined up. There is a flyer in the back. It is going to be Sunday, April 21st. Doors will open at 5 o'clock for like a little reception, champagne, wine, you know, a lovely half hour get together. And then the concert will start at 5:30. And what a lineup we have. The talent on the Treasure Coast is absolutely amazing. Anybody here go and see West Side Story? Okay, we have one, Anita. Anita will be performing. So, and you've all heard Jeff perform, you know, perform. He sang here, You Raise Me Up. And there's a classical singer and whoo, we're excited. And a Broadway singer. Yeah, yeah, we have great talent here. So 21st, make sure you mark your calendars. Holy Week. Today, Palm Passion Sunday. On Thursday, we will have worship at the church property. It is Holy Thursday, known as Maundy Thursday, when we remember Jesus' commandment that is given at the Last Supper, and that will be at 6:30 p.m. If it is raining, we will meet here. So you'll get an email early in the day if it looks like it's going to be raining. Yes, I see the person that sends the email out go like this. Yes, we'll call it in the morning, as they say. Friday, 6:30, here for the Tenebrae service, the service of darkness, where we meditate on the last seven words spoken from the cross. And then on Easter Sunday, we gather here at 10 a.m. as we celebrate the resurrection. So make sure that you grab one of our announcements. There's also a couple of other announcements in there, like a book club, Thrivent. So make sure you grab the announcements. We have the installation of our church council this morning. So, okay then. Thank you. Ooh, that was interesting. So I will be calling up the church council members in a moment, but I want you to hear these words. Dear Christian friends, baptized into the priesthood of Christ, we are all called to offer ourselves to the Lord of the church in thanksgiving for what the Lord has done and continues to do for us. It is our privilege to recognize and support those who are engaged in the work of this congregation, especially those in the ministry of leadership of Living Faith Church, serving on the Congregation Council. Now, the following persons, having been elected by this congregation to the positions of leadership, are asked to come forward as their names are read. Ken Bauer, Jason Demetris, Sue Long, who serves as our president, Doug Snow, who serves as our secretary, Richard Vallone, who serves as our vice president, Pat Walker, who is still under the weather with her back, and Patty Sapiri. Look at you, fell right into line. St. Paul writes, there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit gives them. There are different ways of serving, but the same Lord is served. There are different abilities to perform service, but the same God gives to everyone ability for particular service. The Spirit's presence is shown in some way in each person for the good of all. You have been elected to positions of leadership and trust in God's congregation. You are to see that the words and deeds of this household of faith bear witness to God who gathers us into one together with the whole church. You are to seek to involve all members of this congregation in worship, learning, witness, service, and support, so that the mission of Christ is carried out in this congregation, in the wider church, in this community, and in the whole world. You are to be faithful in your specific area of serving, that the Spirit who empowers you may be glorified. You are to be examples of faith active in love, fostering peace, harmony, and mutual understanding in this congregation. So on behalf of your brothers and sisters in Christ, I ask you, will you accept and faithfully carry out the duties of the offices to which you have been elected? If so, please say, I will, and I ask God to help me.
I will, and I ask God to help.
People of God, I ask you, will you support these, your elected leaders, and will you share in the mutual ministry that Christ has given to all who are baptized? If so, answer in unison, yes, we will, and we ask God to help us. I now declare you installed as officers, council members of this congregation. Almighty God bless you and direct your days and your deeds in peace, that you may be faithful servants of Christ. Amen. Amen. Your council. Thank you. We have a blessing and a farewell that we're going to do now. I normally wait till the end of the service, but this is a very, very emotional and powerful service. So I'm going to invite Dave Pierce to come forward at this time. Now, Terry, I know the tears. I see the tears already. I know. This is a hard one. Oh, the church is a family. United by the common recognition of Jesus Christ as our Savior, we are all brothers and sisters. We are siblings. And for a time, living faith is our home. Like every human family, our church family is formed and reformed over time. As members are born, as they die, members are adopted into our family, and as they leave our congregation for a new home in a different place. For a time, Dave has lived with us. We have shared with him good times and bad. We have shared with each other's joys and sorrows. We have lightened each other's heavy loads. Together, we have laughed and cried. Together, we have worshiped and praised God. Together, we have lived. We feel sorrow in your leaving, yet we rejoice with you in anticipation of this new phase of your life. We will miss your love and support, yet we know you will add much to the lives of those who will be your new church family, as you have added much to our lives. We pray for you and for the whole family of God. Let us pray. O God, you are the strength and the protector of your people. We humbly place in your hands Dave of this congregation, who is moving to Michigan to be closer to his family. Keep and preserve him and his family, O Lord, in all health and safety, both of body and soul, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Go in peace. Go in the peace of Christ. Our prayers go with you. And we have a gift for you from the congregation. Oh, I wonder what that might be. I say that joking because we've had many who have moved north. I'm sorry, I don't get it, but you know, I have no family up there anymore. So for you, Dave, from the congregation, you can feel free to open it now. It's in there, I promise. Would you like some help?
Please. Oh, thank you very much.
For your new home.
It's great.
Yes.
Nice.
Made by Patty. Yeah. Yes, so for you.
Thank you. And I just want to tell everybody, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure. It's been a journey. There's friends I've made I'll never forget. I'll miss you guys. I really will. It's so surreal to even. I'll be out of here Wednesday. And I'm 66, and I'm moving into an apartment for my first time. My garage.
Your first time?
First time ever.
You're lucky. Let me tell you, you're lucky.
But the house I sold, my garage is almost as big as my apartment. And I'll be there for a year till my house is done, but I'll be a mile from my kids for right now. Then when my house is done, I'll be 3 miles away. But you guys have been a blessing. There's so many. And I got to really give a shout out to Frank. He pulled me over on Thursday at Miller's, and we had a talk that I'll never forget. All you guys have been great. I remember telling you I want to get involved with the church. My dad always told me men don't do enough in the church. I said, oh, you got to meet my husband. That was it, man. Only thing I don't do is play golf, but there are golf courses in Michigan. So if any of you come, there's golf courses in Michigan. You always got a place to stay. So thank you guys.
Thank you. Blessings. Yes. Blessings. I invite you to stand as you're able. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for redeeming the world through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Today, Jesus entered the holy city in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and the King by those who spread garments and branches along his way. Bless these branches and those who carry them. Grant us grace to follow our Lord in the way of the cross, so that joined to his death and his resurrection, we enter into life with you. Through the same Jesus Christ who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our gospel this morning is the gospel according to Mark, the 11th chapter. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. And as they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told him what Jesus had said. And the bystanders allowed the disciples to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest." Then Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple, and when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Now, we're not going to process in, but I would love for you to wave your palms high as we sing together, "Hosanna in the highest." As we now enter into the contemplation of the Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ and meditate on the salvation of the world through his sufferings, death, burial, and resurrection, let us pray. O God of mercy and might, in the mystery of your, you offer your infinite life to the world. Gather us around the cross of Christ and preserve us until the resurrection through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. So in this passion narrative, this comes from Mark, and you each have parts in this. So people will be all of us. Men, women, and then I will be the narrator, and we do have a part that was being played by Bob Riedel, whose blood sugar was just a tad bit too high, about 250, so he did get sent home. So Bob is the high priest, and guess what? You're all going to be the high priest. It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. For they said, "Not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people." While Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment of nard, and she broke open the jar and poured the ointment on his head. But some were there who said to one another in anger, and they scolded her. But Jesus said, "Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show kindness to them whenever you wish. But you do not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. Truly I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her." Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. When the chief priests heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give Judas money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray Jesus. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, Jesus' disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. And wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as Jesus had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, Jesus came with the 12, and when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They began to be distressed and to say to Jesus one after another,
"Truly, not I."
And Jesus said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better had he not been born." While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, And after passing it, he broke it, gave it to, after blessing it, he broke it, and he gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly, I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." Come to Christ, broken and poured out for you. I'd like to invite our ushers to take the place to invite our members to come forward for the meal. We just heard the words. This is the Lord's table. This is the Lord's supper. This is the new covenant made in the body and blood of our Lord Jesus for us once and forever. This is the grace that we have been given, each one of us forgiven. Come forward, taste the grace, receive the gift that has been given and shed for you. I'd like to invite the communion assistants to come forward at this time, and the musicians to come forward. As you come forward, you'll be handed a piece of bread and invited to dip that into one of the two chalices which contain wine. If you have any type of a gluten intolerance, just let your communion server know, and we have a gluten-free option for you. If you have any type of an allergy to wine, we also have a grape juice option. So come, the table is set, and all are invited. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Amen. Now I invite you to be seated. When they had finished dinner and sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised, I will go before you to Galilee." Peter said to him, and Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, Peter, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." But Peter said vehemently, and all of them said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." I invite you to stand for our prayers of intercession. Led by Christ in our journey of repentance and moved by his compassion, let us pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. We pray for the church, that congregations be a home for the lost, a haven for the oppressed, and a source of healing for those broken by life's circumstances. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for new life springing forth from the earth, for those who groan in labor, those who are adopting children, and those who are unable to conceive. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for Christians who do not have the freedom to worship openly, for political prisoners, refugees, widows, and orphans. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who care for the weary and the vulnerable, nurses, hospice workers, child care providers, and social workers. We pray for those in any need, especially those we name aloud before you now. Lucy, Manny, Pat, Pete, Bill, Guy, Terry, Cecilia, Rick, as he prepares for his surgery tomorrow, Michael, Mary Lou, Rocco, Tyler, Bob, Angela, Jennifer, Joe, Jackie, Jody, Anita, Dave, Patrick, Lynn, Ray, Mark, Dwayne, Lene, Nancy, John, Carter, Henry, Glenn, Gertrude, Beverly, Karen, and the family of friends of Kevin Cantagallo at his unexpected passing, and the family and friends of Dee Smith as the Lord has taken her home after her battle with cancer. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for this assembly, Living Faith, as we enter this Holy Week. Open our hearts that we may begin to understand the magnitude of your faithfulness to us in the gift poured out to us in the death of Jesus, your beloved Son. Sustain us and bring us all to the joy of Easter. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, remember your covenant with us and write it on our hearts until we join with all the saints around your heavenly throne. Lord, in your mercy. We give thanks for the blessed saints who showed us how to live and taught us how to die. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. You may be seated. Now Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated. And Jesus said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake." And going a little farther, Jesus threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, "Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." Jesus came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." And again, Jesus went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more, Jesus came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to Jesus. And then Jesus came a third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "So when he came, Judas went up to Jesus at once and said," and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. And Jesus said to them, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled. all of them deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him in a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying,
"I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another, not made with hands."
But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
"Testify against you."
But Jesus was silent and did not answer. And again, the high priest asked him,
"Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Jesus said, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"Why do we still need witnesses? Blasphemy?"
All of them condemned him as deserving death. And some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying, The guards also took him over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said, But Peter denied it, saying, And Peter went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed, and the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders, but again, Peter denied it. Then, after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, but Peter began to curse, and he swore an oath. At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times." And Peter broke down and wept. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him,
"Are you king of the Jews?"
He answered him, "You say so." Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again,
"You have no answer? See how many charges they bring against you."
But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then Pilate answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For Pilate realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. And Pilate spoke to them again,
"Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
And they shouted back. Pilate asked them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, Pilate handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort, and they clothed him in a purple cloak. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting Jesus. Hail, King of the Jews. They struck his head with a reed, spat upon Jesus, and knelt down in homage to Jesus. After mocking Jesus, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led Jesus out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And they offered Jesus wine mixed with myrrh. But Jesus did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified Jesus. The inscription of the charge against Jesus read, "The King of the Jews." And with him, they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "Aha, you who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with Jesus also taunted Jesus. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, and someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to Jesus to drink, saying, and then Jesus gave out a loud cry and breathed his last.
Sacrifice, the Son of God, give.
and the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now, when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, the centurion said, "Truly, this man was God's son." There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of James the younger, and of Joseph, and Salome. These used to follow Jesus and provide for Jesus when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up with Jesus to Jerusalem. When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked the centurion whether Jesus had been dead for some time. When Pilate learned from the centurion that Jesus was dead, Pilate granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph bought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. Joseph then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid. Let us now generously return to God a portion of the treasure God has entrusted to us. This time, you're invited to come forward to make your offering to our Lord. And in doing so, you're instilling your trust in the work that we are doing here at Living Faith. And I thank you for that. For those of you who make your offering online and have done so already, thank you. And for those of you who would like to make your offering online, you can do so now by going to lfc.church. And for those of you who make your offering in person, you are invited to do so at this time. Mariano will be bringing us the gift of his voice in his song.
And then Peter remembered what Jesus had told him. And Peter wept for what he had done. What have I done? Denied him. What have I done? So now I am no different from the men who take thy bread and turn again. Oh, what have I done? What have I done? I hear their filthy tongues, their vicious scorn, the lies they spin with Satan's yarn. I watch them spit and strike thy face, they mock thy name in foul disgrace. And when thou lookest for a friend, thou findest none, for I have fled. Oh, come! What have I done? As thou hast taken stripes for me, could I not take but one for thee? I cannot watch them take my Lord. I can't endure the cruel hands upon him, while his own hands are tied with cord. Those hands with power to raise the dead, command the storm now bound instead. I cannot hear them mock his name. I cannot bear their foul breath upon him. I dare not look upon his face and see the very Son of God, his brow so bruised and stained with blood, his eyes that shed my sorrow's fear, and watch as all hope disappears. I will not watch them crucify. Cannot watch what he must bear, for surely he must carry all my burden. Forgive me, Lord, that I'm not there. But when my eyes are closed in death, these words will hang upon my last breath. I know him.
So I do want to share that Mariano wanted to sing that last year, and
it was too hard.
And the only way you can sing that is embracing Peter and who Peter was and who Peter is for us, because you know what? We're all Peters. Thank you, Mariano, for the braveness. I invite you to stand now as you're able. God, our provider, you have not fed us with bread alone, but with words of grace and life. Bless us and these your gifts, which we receive from your bounty, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. You can stay standing for our sending hymn.
Thank you.
let us go now into the world and serve those who cry out in pain and anguish, that they may know God's mercy and grace poured out in Christ alone. We go forth together, living our faith, knowing that everywhere we go, everyone we meet, everything we do, we are Christ's hands and feet. So let's go.